It's great to come in and get together with this many folks here in Phoenix to talk about one of the long-term projects that we've been doing down in the greater Tucson and southern Arizona area. Our great our Edge of Salado project was an NSF-funded project. Back in the day, Lewis Bork was a preservation fellow with Archaeology Southwest. And so today, Lewis is going to talk about sort of the how we went about trying to measure the edges or what causes an inclusive ideology that sort of sweeps across the landscape to have boundaries to how far it extends. So that was one of the core interests of that Edge of Salado project. And I'm going to turn it over to Lewis to talk about some of the fieldwork, some of the results, and we can have a discussion about what its implications are for the Phoenix area. So, Lewis.
Okay, how's that? So you can tell that I'm giving this talk in the southern southwest, particularly in Arizona, because Snaketown ends up on there quite a bit. Having worked up in northern southwest quite a lot, I can promise you that Snaketown would not show up out there. There's definitely divides in these sites. But the vast majority of sites that people have chosen here, Mesa, and I gave you kind of the option to pick like groupings of sites too. So Mesa Verde shows up on here, Chaco Canyon, Pacimay, Snaketown. These are all sites that are fairly, in the grand scheme of things, in the greater southwest, these are all sites and regions that are fairly hierarchically organized that people often pick as important sites. And that itself becomes important. And it becomes important in these broader aspects, too. And so this is actually a pie chart that was published in, it's going to be in the International Journal of Contemporary Archaeology, but it was also just in the SA Archaeological Record, which is kind of like a trade mag that goes out to a lot of archaeologists. And it's a breakdown of the horizontal or vertical organizations, so hierarchical or more egalitarian organizations of the societies whose sites are protected by UNESCO. So the UNESCO World Heritage Sites, whether these sites are products of a hierarchical society or a more horizontally organized society. And you can see, you probably can't see, but the blues are hierarchically or vertically organized, and the white pie slices are horizontally organized. And so UNESCO has also heavily sided with picking to preserve sites that are vertically or hierarchically organized. And so you can kind of think of these as proxies for states, basically, right? So in Mexico, a lot of them are built around Aztec sites. In the United States, a lot of them are early U.S. colonial sites. A lot of them are places like Chaco Canyon. But this becomes important because archaeology as a discipline, just like history or really any historical science, is fundamentally political. So the choices we're making about how we discuss the past and how we preserve the past and how we talk about the past fundamentally impacts what we talk about and do in the present day. So if you change what your past looks like, then you're changing essentially what your future looks like. And archaeologists and geographers actually and historians talk about this as historical imagination, right? So history on some level is sort of like this repository where we have all these different ideas on how we can organize, how we can try and effectively work together. And what we're doing by over picking, essentially, over sampling, I guess you could say, these hierarchical organizations is to sort of like blend out or move out or erase all of these different ways of people organizing. So it becomes a lot more difficult for us to understand ways to organize outside of someone telling you how to do something. So these kind of group decision-making practices that are more egalitarian become a lot more difficult to imagine. Okay, so one of the things I wanted to, this sort of kind of thinking about ideas like this made me start thinking about these sort of broader patterns that you see in the Southwest. And we often talk about these sort of transitions that happen in societies where people sort of disperse across the landscape. And we use terms like collapse or failure for these periods. And I kind of wanted to start thinking about, well, if we're already sort of erasing these different ideas about how we can organize, what does this mean for understanding or how we interpret the archaeological record, right? So what if we kind of reverse that image? So right now, there's a very particular focus that all of you guys have, which is this whole room kind of looking at me, the cameras looking at me. But there's another perspective that's happening here, and that's coming from my side, right? So yeah, there we go. So the whole, you guys are definitely the majority here, that your perspective outweighs my perspective. But there's another perspective in this room, and I'm gonna walk right up to Victoria and the camera here, because she's gonna have to do some editing magic later and probably get rid of me talking about this. All right, but that's important. Like, these different perspectives are important. They actually help us to understand things in a different way and help us realize what amounts to sort of unintended, because this isn't really a critique on people purposely trying to change the past, but these sort of unintended biases that help us, that sort of lead us a little bit when we're interpreting the archaeological record. So I wanted to sort of try and look at this in a different perspective to see if maybe there's a different understanding that can come out from this sort of reversal. Okay, so that's when Bill gave me a fellowship at Archaeology Southwest, and I joined the Edge of Salado project, and we started fieldwork, and it all kind of linked up with a lot of interest that I had. But so this is, as we started these projects, I kind of was thinking about, you know, in the Southwest, what if instead of thinking about why in North America, outside of Mexico, or why at least in the Southwest, did states fail to develop? Why don't we start thinking about why were states successfully stopped from developing, right? What if this is actually a product of success instead of a product of failure? All right, so the whole thing was sort of built on, the whole project that I walked into, this Edge of Salado project, is sort of built on understanding why Salado stopped. And as I started to get a better understanding of the material culture, the two ideas, these two kind of interests sort of aligned. The heavens opened. Okay, so this is the area, of course, this is the greater Southwest. And I think Bill and Jeff talked about, I think Jeff actually talked about Salado last week, and this is, it emerged out of a migration by Kayenta and Tusayan groups from the ancestral Pueblo area down into the Mogollon and Hohokam regions. And it's a lot more complicated than that, and I'm not going to get into the specifics of Salado, and you guys actually all have fact sheets too that you can follow up on and read. But what ended up happening is, after a generation or two of hanging out with local groups in the Mogollon region and the Hohokam region, this thing that we call Salado, which we've argued based on patterns of distribution of ceramics and how those ceramics are produced and how information to make those ceramics is transmitted, is material evidence of this inclusive ideology. Okay, so that's sort of the broad picture. And then the Edge of Salado project was really focused on sort of understanding areas where it may have continued to spread or it may have not continued to spread. So we had these sort of research transects, one of which was down through here. I actually have markers so I can draw them. And that's in the, if you guys know where Douglas is like right down here. It was through the San Bernardino and Sulphur Springs area over there. And then we had another Western research transect, which was between Tucson and the Tonawtum tribal lands out in the Altar Valley in the Coyote Mountains. It wasn't actually that big. It's like that, really. Excuse me. Okay. So these two areas have a lot of interesting things to say, and part of the reason that we picked them to work on is because when there's been a couple of large projects that have happened. I've been working on a project with Jeff Clark from Archaeology Southwest and Barbara Mills called the Southwest Social Network Project, which and Matt Peoples, actually, who's back at the last table there, that brought together this massive amount of ceramic data. And so we're able to kind of look at where there are holes in that data set and kind of tactically target those areas to help fill in those holes. So we weren't actually doing large-scale excavations in which we're getting like very detailed information about the life histories of these sites. What we're basically doing is trying to get samples of data from these sites to fill in for analyses at a regional scale. And that was really the big picture here, is because we're trying to understand these large-scale patterns. And so we can actually, using a preservation focus, where we just focus more on targeting middens and not heavily impacting the sites, we can start to work on these sites and fill in our information from there. But specifics of what we found was actually, like archaeology itself, both unsurprising and interesting. So in the southeast Arizona area here, we were working in the Sulphur Springs Valley and the San Bernardino Valley. And the sites we're focusing on, this is all late classic period stuff. So depending on where you're at, those time periods change, but it's going to be about AD 1100, 1150, to the magic date of AD 1450, which we use as an end date for the Ho-Kam. Depending on who you talk to, that means Ho-Kam stopped and the people who lived here left. But I think a growing number of archaeologists and, of course, an always steady large number of Autumn people have argued that there's been continued presence between the Ho-Kam and Autumn peoples themselves. And I'll talk a little bit more about why I think that may be the case. But what we're seeing down here is we're targeting smaller sites. So we're not looking at these massive 100 room sites. A lot of the sites had they had more than 12 rooms, but less than 30 usually. So they're smaller. The sites we worked at in southeast Arizona, there are five sites down there. They're all close to the Pacime area, Casas Grandes region, which is down here. And these sites had large numbers of Salado polychrome ceramics, or they had large numbers of Casas Grandes Chihuahuan series ceramics. So it was generally an either or. You didn't usually get like a 50-50 mix. You'd get mostly Salado and some Chihuahuan, or mostly Chihuahuan and some Salado. And the Salado sites generally had a lot of obsidian coming from Mule Creek, which is up in the Mogollon area, and an area that Archaeology Southwest has been doing a lot of field work at. Catherine Dungan has been done a bunch of field work out there, and Leslie Aragon in the back there. And so we know that oftentimes these sites that have Salado ceramics frequently have obsidian coming from this Mule Creek source, and there's a lot of Salado sites in that region. Okay, there's also very little shell that occurred out here, which is probably unsurprising. And the animal assemblage, the stuff they're eating or at least throwing in their garbage, there weren't any carnivores, which is can be a surprise because you generally expect to have some dogs, while always present, don't always have a heavy presence in the archaeological record down south here, but you expect to see some. In this area, they ate four times as much jackrabbit as a cottontail. So that's actually kind of important because the hunting methods for cottontails and jackrabbits are totally different. Cottontails, you generally eat, does anyone know it's gonna be best to kill a cottontail? No one will judge you for killing a sweet bunny if you tell me.
Golf course.
Yeah, all right, exactly. That's actually not a bad answer, it's true. But it's because they're looking for easy food. They're lazy, basically. So they're going to be out in cornfields and stuff, right? So when you have a lot of cottontail, that means people are mostly eating, getting meat from right around where they're farming at. When you have a lot of jackrabbit, when you have a lot more jackrabbit than cottontail, that means they're actually going out to hunt generally. And you usually, when you have a lot of jackrabbit, these sites often, not always, depending on the what the environment is like, but they often have a lot of artiodactyls too, so antelope and mule deer and coos. But 4-1, so they're still going out to hunt jackrabbits fairly regularly. They're getting juniper and oak for fuel. Okay, so nothing surprising. And for agriculture, they're eating primarily what we're seeing archaeologically is a lot of corn. And agave was actually kind of a surprise for me down here. And that's because of our sample, that's something to explore in the future. But it's interesting unexpected. But we also have a lot of turquoise and blue-green stone coming out of this area. And there was a small tesserae piece that came out of this site called the Christian site that was right there. So now you guys know exactly where it's at, right? But one of the things that we saw from the groundstone assemblage is that there's a lot of weaving and fiber manufacture happening in this area. And whether that's coming from cotton or whether it's coming from yucca, it wasn't determinable, but there's a lot of textile manufacture that's taking place there and early on. And finally, what we're seeing is for projectile points, there's a lot of late classic period points. So they're the right time period, which is, you know, like around 1300. But there's also a lot of scavenged early agricultural points in this region, which is interesting in itself. The whole kind of curational behavior and reuse of projectile points is fun. And I think it probably has to do a lot with the fact that there's a really important place for Paleo-Indian and archaic period hunters. So there's just a lot of points on the ground to be picked up. When we move out west, when you get over into the Cowdy Mountains here, and that's right on the eastern edge of the Autumn tribal lands, there's a different pattern that happens. The sites out here had a wider temporal range. They're occupied from about 900 to 1450. I should say inhabited. Kate, who edits all of the archaeologists at Archaeology Southwest, has been hitting us with a big stick to stop saying occupied, because it sounds like there's a military occupation in these areas. But people are living there, and sometimes there's a military occupation. But so it's about 900 to 1450, depending. And this area is interesting because it's got a lot of little tiny platform mounds. But there's a lot of shell artifacts, which makes sense because they're getting the shell from down here. And people have argued that these sites are actually right on this large-scale shell trade network that's coming down through Phoenix and through Tucson to acquire shell. And these shells are, there's shell manufacturing that's happening, but a lot of them were fairly intact. And you've got beads, tinklers, pendants, and bracelets, primarily glycimerous shell. And there's a large amount of artifacts that come from the classic period, which is primarily the tinklers and the large bracelets. I was just telling Leslie, tinklers always makes me laugh whenever I say it. So one weird thing out here is that there's no bird taxa. There's no species of birds we found in our excavation units, and that's pretty rare for faunal assemblages. I'm not going to interpret what that means because I don't know, but there's some interesting patterns of possible patterns of avoidance of birds out there. There's also a crazy amount of jackrabbits to cottontails. It's 27 jackrabbits for every cottontail out there. So these guys and women are out heavily hunting jackrabbits on the landscape. So we know there's agriculture happening out here, but it seems they're primary meat source is not cottontail. They're not getting a lot of food from cottontails and from their corn and agave fields. And that's another thing we have evidence for out here. There's also, when we're excavating, there's these things that we all call, archaeologists call tabular knives. And we call them agave knives. And they're these big, flat, usually some kind of sedimentary rock that's like roughly sharpened on one edge, and it's sort of like the dullest butcher knife you've ever held in your hand. And it's what we argue usually is that it's used for butchering agave, for getting the leaves off and getting to the hearts. There's this wonderful groundstone analyst at Desert Archaeology who actually wrote the book on groundstone analysis, and I think now it's two books on groundstone analysis. And one of the people I'm working with in the Netherlands was fascinated that I knew her. He was very excited about that. So Jenny has got quite the international reputation, but she did the analysis for our assemblage. And what she was saying was that when she's looking under the microscopes at the use wear, at how these artifacts were used, some of them look like they're used on agave, but the vast majority were actually used to process, let's see where I was here, were used for woodworking or for fiber processing. So added to that, there's a lot of other groundstone that she said has use wear analysis that look like they were used for spinning and weaving tasks. This whole area out here seems like it may be heavily related to the production of textiles also. And that's not totally a surprise, because some of the earliest surveys out there found like massive amounts of spindle whorls, which are these stone or ceramic discs that you use to run up your yarn, basically, which many people know a lot more about than I do, because I've never particularly been good at textile analysis. But we also found this thing called a plummet stone. It's not a plummet stone. We don't really know what they are. And I'll let you guys see my amazing artistic skills, and we'll hope it turns out all right. But plummet stones were argued to be originally argued to be construction implements, and I don't know. It's not this big. It was about that big. Maybe it's a chili pepper effigy. I don't know. But I joke that it was an earplug. But it's people have argued that they're gourd stopper bottles also, and that they were actual plumb bobs or plummet stones for construction. What we do know is that they have a really high. They're found very frequently with late classic or classic period platform mound sites. So. There's always been some conversation amongst archaeologists whether these tiny platform mounds out in the Cowdy Mountains are actually platform mounds, because they're like two of these tables put together, maybe like cut in half lengthwise and put together. They're small. They're like 6 foot by 6 foot or something, and maybe like 3-4 feet tall. They're not gigantic like the ones that you see in the Phoenix Basin, and they're in a totally different pattern on the landscape, which I will get to. Okay, so plummet stones. We've got projectile points from this period. There's not a whole lot of early curated points. And almost no obsidian. Also, very importantly out here, it was 3,000-ish sherds that I analyzed from this collection. We had three pieces of Roosevelt redware, Salado polychrome. So there's these places are inhabited at the exact same time that Salado, that people are living in regions all through here, and there's a lot of Salado out here, and eventually in the Tucson Basin, and then eventually at least at three sites in the Phoenix Basin, all through the Safford and San Pedro. There we go. But it never got out here. So it based on models that I've run, these people had to have known about it. And you can see it move through the Tucson Basin, and there's this progression, this clinal progression from east to west, where you see a lot of Salado polychrome, and then it gets a lot less as you move further west. And there's also a transition in how people build platform mounds, and you have a couple sites, or at least one site in the Tucson Basin, where people are building platform mounds like you see out in the Cowdy Mountains, where there's small platform mounds, each associated with an adobe compound. But then there's a whole bunch of them at a site. So you're not just getting one or two large platform mounds per site, you're getting multiple platform mounds per site. There's a lot more access to that platform mounds. So the grand scheme of things is that starts to tell a story, I thought, and I do think still. And it kind of highlights that there are these fissures that happen ideologically or religious fissures on the landscape, right? And so this marker's toast. So what you're getting, and this is going to be a real rough draw, but you're getting this sort of coming down through here, and then you're getting one right through here. And areas outside of this, you don't really get Salado spreading. You get a little bit up here, and it's kind of an interesting pattern that happens up there. But it's probably related to people leaving the southern Arizona and moving back up north after 1450 or so. So by just looking at how ceramics are distributed across the landscape, and that was kind of the main point of doing this Edge of Salado stuff, figuring out where Salado ceramics continue to. And down here, we know they go into the Casas Grandes area, and there's a type of local ceramics down here that looks a lot like Salado polychrome, and That's a whole nother research project that someday I will get money to do. But what these distributions start to kind of demonstrate is that you have these pretty dramatic distributions. I've said that like seven times. That's awesome. You get these pretty dramatic the spread or movement of ideas across the landscape, and how those ideas spread, because it's not just in this particular case, it's not just ceramics that are moving, because most of these ceramics are made locally, so it's the ideas embedded within these ceramics that are moving. And so why, like Bill mentioned at the beginning, why it moves in some areas and doesn't move in other areas becomes important. And so some of the early ideas that we've had for what Salado is have tried to deal with this a little bit. And then starting in the mid-90s, we kind of came onto this idea that, oh, you know, based on the patterns and distributions, it appears that it's the material evidence of this religious movement. Okay. That's totally right. It is. One of the great things that Jeff Clark did was kind of demonstrate that this is like an inclusive ideology that ties together these multi-ethnic communities. And that's definitely true also. But what we need to start asking is, why then does it start to move into areas where it doesn't need to be, where an inclusive ideology isn't necessarily useful? Why does it move into areas that aren't multi-ethnic? Why is it moving into these regions where you don't see these kind of mixed peoples living together? And so then we have to start looking at other patterns that may be popping up. And for me, that pattern had to relate to what we see kind of like historically through the Hohokam region. Not that one. That one. Which is this pattern through time that we see in changing organization of the political structures. And out here in the Southwest, politics and religion, and not just out here in the Southwest, even nowadays, politics and religion are intricately interconnected, right? So in the Southwest, we can actually look at religious practices to understand how knowledge and information are distributed and controlled. And in the Hohokam region, this is the kind of a rough approximation of the pattern we get through time, with groups on the bottom here having a larger open access, more open access to religious knowledge, and groups up on the top having kind of restricted control of religious knowledge. So it's fewer people having the ability to conduct these ritual practices, and therefore having the ability to kind of control the political situation in these groups. And so as it changes through time here, and this is the what we call a large house period, and this is the ball court period, it's more decentralized. And then we start to move up into the platform mound system. And when the platform mound system comes about, and this is the most hierarchical period that we get in the Hohokam region, which is one of the, this is about when Salado pops up and becomes incredibly effective at moving through these regions. And so the regions that it moves through, it's not simply that it's moving through areas where it's tying together multiple ethnic groups or groups with different social identities. Where it's most effective at moving is in areas that have hierarchical religious and political systems. So it moves really well and early into the sort of edge of the Casas Grandes system. It moves really well through the Safford Valley and San Pedro Valley, where the platform mound systems are moving in. And it's most effective at moving into these regions when that hierarchical system is pretty new, when it hasn't really become incredibly entrenched, and the people living there, the grandparents, remembered living outside of that system. And we see this transition from the control of religious knowledge that happens as you move out of the ball courts into this period where there's not really ball courts or platform mounds, and then into the platform mound system, as you see that in the rock art also. Aaron Wright, who's also at Archaeology Southwest, has done a wonderful study of rock art around the Phoenix Basin and seen how, and has argued that you see that sort of ability for everybody to participate religiously drop off in the classic period with the rise of the ball courts. Okay, so I think I'm actually starting to run out of time here, so I'm gonna speed up, because this is the main point anyways. But so the standard perspective, and this is broad strokes. There's a whole lot of different ways that archaeologists have have looked at these transitions. And in the HOACOM area, they've actually been really pretty good. What we are at right now is trying to figure out what's happening here. And a lot of times, the way we have been discussing it is that it's this environmental collapse that happens right at this period. And that's why there's an argument that the whole area was abandoned. And then there's a later reoccupation or a movement of people in from Mexico into the southern Arizona. What I think is happening, and what I've argued is happening, is that in the HOACOM region, there's a particular pattern of contesting these transitions and hierarchy, basically. So this little bit of hierarchy that happened in the large house period was contested, and Henry Wallace has argued this, not in the same terms, but functionally the same, with the ball court period. There's this sort of emergence of people able to actually participate in their religious and political lives that happens again. Leslie and I have a fun argument about that we'll talk about maybe at some point too, but I think this may have been driven by women, and I think the Salado social movement may have been driven by women too, and that says a lot about political practice in the HOACOM region and in prehistory. But what happens, the reason people have talked about collapse is we stop to see these large-scale platform mounds being built, we stop seeing these large adobe compounds that are being built at this time, and then there's this reversion to pit houses, which is what we were living in from here backwards, right? And so what I think is happening, whether it's sort of a jump start, right? There's this movement of people that come down from up north, and they're kind of working on these particular ideas of how to stay outside of the Chaco sphere, because there's this absence of a lot of Chaco-related control in the Kayenta region in particular. And they're moving into this region, and they're moving into regions where this hierarchical controlled platform mound system has just shown up. And they're starting up this religious practices. Their more controlled religious practices, especially ones focusing around kivas, go away pretty quickly. And then this emergence of Salado is sort of this melding of local communities, the HOACOM communities, and migrant descendants, essentially. And that it's fundamentally built around this idea of inclusivity, of course, as people have argued, but it's also a political movement. It's not just a religious movement, and it's built around contesting control of political power in these communities, which is also control of religious power. And so it moves basically out from these nexi, these nodes, and spreads across the landscape, and as Bill mentioned, it spreads really rapidly. Archaeologically, it spreads really rapidly. Geologically, it was really quick. But archaeologically, it over the course of about 200 years, it moves across a huge swath of this area. But there are holdouts where the platform mound system is a lot more entrenched. Tucson's one of them, and Phoenix Basin's another. And the Phoenix Basin data, we need to. It's at least the data I have access to. It's a lot more limited. But what gets interesting is you start to see this sort of post-classic period that archaeologists call the Pole of Rome period, this movement back into pit houses, and there's some sort of powerful indications that they have issues with the previous period of hierarchy. There's Pole of Rome pit house built right on top of a platform mound, for example. But a lot of this matches up with some autumn oral traditions also, but I'm going to wrap up quickly. I actually have a whole bunch more that I was going to talk about, but I don't so have time to talk about it. So the broad gist of this is that our ability to kind of take on this large regional scale by sampling these small sites with the Edge of Salado project helps sort of fill in these gaps where we can start to look at where and when things move across the landscape. More importantly, is this also allows us to look at connections at that time period, so contemporaneous connections between these communities, and these are sort of ideological connections or connections of choice, if you will. People are having to make decisions on which religious practice they're going to participate in, and there's some things that are standardized amongst them that don't change dramatically, but for the most part, people are either choosing to participate in the platform mound system, which is also ceramically sort of linked with the resurgence of local run-on brown and run-on buff wares, or the Salado religious practice, which is linked with these ideologically charged polychromes. So you've got these connections that are happening all across this landscape. And there's like three Archaeology Southwest magazines that I would really suggest reading. But one of them that really ties in this idea of these connections is the Social Network one that we did a couple years ago. Beyond having like some of the best graphics that I think that magazine issues have had, it really is impossible to not pick up like how interconnected these groups were. And these aren't from trading items, they're from exchanging ideas, basically. But this also allows us to look at how I don't want to say egalitarian, because egalitarian is this loaded word, and it's we all know it's very difficult to make decisions in an egalitarian manner, but these more egalitarian or more equitable structures, how they're able to contest these more hierarchical structures successfully is incredibly important, and especially in the contemporary political climate, regardless of what side of the aisle you're on, understanding how to organize collectively and make decisions where one person isn't fundamentally in charge in a good or bad way, often in a bad way, is something that we have sort of fallen by the wayside in thinking is possible, right? It's there's not very many people. If you're just walking down the street and there's six of you and you are trying to figure out where you're going to go eat, it often ends up where someone is just like, stop talking, we're going here. And that happens generally because we don't have embedded social institutions for decision-making practices. And so that's the connection to the present. These people were putting together these sort of large-scale social institutions for equitable practice and decision-making purposes. And so there are possibilities for alternative social organizations, whether not talking about replacement, but kind of helping us out in the modern world a little bit. But we're going to take questions now. And I'll walk around with the mic, too. Yes,
Why were you surprised at the agave?
Out here?
Yes.
I was surprised by the agave out here. I maybe shouldn't have been. This is kind of generally considered outside of the Ho'okam sphere, and all through here and through the San Pedro Valley, I would have expected it in Safford Valley, but. There hasn't been a lot of archaeological work done out here, and that has been something that has been not highlighted in the excavations that have happened out there, so I wasn't expecting to see it. It's more talked about as this Animas phase sites is what they're called, and they're sort of a mix between Mogollon and Casas Grandes sites, and there's some Mimbres sites down here too. So I was more expecting evidence of corn agriculture and things like that.
Second question is, did you find evidence for irrigation or Akchen fields?
Yeah. No. They probably exist, but since we weren't focused on getting the life history of the sites, we weren't doing large-scale surveys around there. And a lot of the sites we're working on are actually on private land, so we didn't actually have permission to move outside of those regions, too. And one of the sites that we're working on private land, it's listed as two sites, and it's really frustrating because the second site, so we call it the Christian site, we call it the Christian South site because the person who owns it, it's not, there wasn't a cross or anything out there, their last name is Christian. But the Christian North site's 100 meters away, it's like 300 feet away, and it's another giant room block, but you just can't, we can see it, we just can't go to it because there's another landowner. So they've been recorded as two different sites, but it's one site.
I was wondering what kind of population numbers in this time periods that you would anticipate that there was over there.
That's a good question. And that's something that I don't have really good answers for. The sites that we're looking at out here are occupied, some of them for like 50 years and some of them for a couple hundred. But none of them have rooms that are larger than, well, that one I was just talking about is probably 60 to 100 rooms, but most of them are around like 12 to 30 rooms. And you split that up over a couple generations and you're not looking at more than a few families in these sites. And there's a number of them out there, but in terms of demography, in terms of population density, out here is nothing like what we're seeing in the Phoenix Basin, for sure, or the Safford Valley, which is probably, if not as demographically dense as a Phoenix Basin, as second, and then San Pedro and Tucson. But I mean, you're only talking about a couple thousand people out there probably. When you're getting into the Cowdy Mountains, that might go up. It's fairly dense with adobe compounds out there during this period, but I would also not, it's also in a lot more compressed area, so I wouldn't expect it to be more than 1,000 people or so.
Is it also because of the location they are, it's not suitable for very much agriculture as we think of it and as the Ho'okam people think of it? You know, you're saying smaller and agave and corn, and that's about it. Lots of hunting and gathering?
Yeah. So there's probably a little bit of irrigation that's happening, but for the most part, it's probably Ak-Chin farming. And it's definitely, the population size is almost assuredly a product of what that environment can maintain. Other questions? There's one.
excuse me. I'm more curious about some of the platform mounds. So the way I kind of understand, you think the platform mounds were a separate thing from the Salado movement, and how would you determine that? Because I'm from the Tano Basin,
sure,
and
yeah.
A lot of those platform mounds have Salado polychromes, tons of them. So
yeah.
Just curious.
Yeah. So one of the reasons that, I mean, that's one of the arguments, right, is that one of the early arguments is that Salado is this, is fundamentally intertwined with the platform mounds. But in a lot of regions, the presence of Salado on a platform mound site doesn't necessarily stress me out, because, I mean, if you're thinking about these things as two competing ideologies, it's not problematic. What we do see in a lot of regions is a fundamental separation between the two, especially down through the San Pedro and Safford Valley and Tucson Basin. And Phoenix and Tano, the picture muddies a lot, and that's not bad. That actually gets really interesting up here. And one of the reasons when you look at Salado as essentially a social movement, what happens is you start to get these ideas, and this comes from about 150 years of research in sociology and geography and history is on social movements, is you start to get mobilizations and counter mobilizations and people co-opting messages and imagery and things like that. And that's definitely happening outside of Tucson. They're not co-opting the imagery of Salado, but they've transitioned that platform mound system into a much more equitably distributed system where more people have access to these mounds. They're not restricted to a few people. There's a lot per site. And up here in the Phoenix Basin, the Tano Basin, it's more complicated than that, and I think it has a lot more to do with how the ideology is moving in, as people are moving in, especially for seasonal labor and stuff too. And I mean, my personal understanding, my personal ideas on this is that there's a co-optation of imagery associated with that, but not like a transition in power practices that's happened. And I think eventually that changes. But I mean, that's my understanding of, that's why I think there are, especially in Tano, why there are these large numbers of Salado ceramics with platform mounds. But the pattern doesn't hold elsewhere, and so that's why I think it is different up there. Other questions? Victoria, your hand's up. Do you have one? Did you have one?
Yes.
Yeah.
Do you think the occurrence of Salado in different places, like the Ho'okam platform mounds, are a result of trade? That hasn't been mentioned.
Yeah, and so that's one of those things. I'm glad you brought that up, because that's one of those things that is in my head, but it's put to rest in my head, so I forget to bring it up. And that was one of the original arguments. And actually, Randy McGuire still fundamentally, he's an archaeologist out at University of Binghamton. his idea is that Salado pottery is a product of itinerant trade specialists, basically. So, I mean, he's got a very economic focus on this. The pattern doesn't really hold too well, though, because we see like it's the broader material culture associated with these sites doesn't really hold for people just coming through briefly, making pots, selling them, and leaving. And then the stuff that Patty Crown has done, and since then that like Deb Huntley and a lot of other people have done, based on petrographic and neutron activation analyses, have demonstrated that Salado's generally built or made where it's found at. There's some rare exceptions to that, and that's why when Patty did this, she wrote a book in 1994, I think it was published. And that was her sort of massive contribution, and it was a big contribution. It massively changed how we were thinking about Salado, because at that point, trade was a large part of it, or a conquering group rampaging down from the Pueblo plateau. But what Patty argued very convincingly is that this distribution is not based on trade, because then you'd be looking at kind of limited areas of production, and then the ceramics moving out from those areas. Instead, what you're getting is multiple areas of production, decentralized production of Salado all across the landscape and mostly in the areas that it's found. And so her argument then is that it's not the pots that are moving, it's the ideas about how to make the pots that are moving, and sometimes it's the people as well. Other questions? Oh, there's some people I see hands trying to go up a little bit. No? Okay. Well, you guys can ask me more questions afterwards as I get drunk.